Welcome back to another episode of Microservices TV. I'm Rick Osowski, and I'm here with Kyle Brown, Distinguished Engineer and CTO of IBM Cloud Lab Services. We're going to follow up on one of Kyle's talks that we had previously, which was refactoring for microservices. And today we're going to cover refactoring data for microservices. So let's go ahead and jump in on the first topic of, I'm sure there's many different topics in here.
Yeah, there are. And the first one is probably one that you and I were talking about during our last talk, but also that you and I have had several other talks about in between. And that's this question of, when do you and do you not want to even consider refactoring your data for microservices? Mm-hmm. Because the thing about the microservices architecture is it has a lot of things tied up into it. And the perception that people sometimes have of what is and is not part of a microservices architecture really influences the way that they look at it. A lot of times what will happen is I'll be talking to a customer, and as part of the architectural discussions we're having about other things like containers or things like that, the question of microservices will come up. And we'll talk a little bit about benefits that you can gain from the microservices approach, and we'll hear the same thing back, which is, oh, we couldn't do that, our data is way too complicated, or we've invested too much in our enterprise data modeling, or it's too hard for us to even look at the data. Mm-hmm. Like that. And granted, not every enterprise customer is going to be in the same kind of situation that a Netflix would be in. So you can't exactly compare the two together. But at the same time, what we have found is that there are some cases where it does apply and some cases where refactoring your data simply does not apply. And you also have to kind of make sure you understand what perspective you're looking at it from. Let me give you, just one example of a kind of a different perspective. A lot of times when we look at microservices, we're looking at it from a very developer-oriented perspective. Mm-hmm. Because we're thinking about what it means to make the developers' lives easier, make the code easier to maintain, easier to deploy, easier to manage and monitor. But developers, especially in large enterprises, are not the only people that are involved in these big projects. You also have the folks that are responsible for the data. You've got the DBAs, and you've got the data modelers and those folks. And they face their own set of challenges that in many cases are as difficult to solve and as complicated as the ones that the developers are solving. This one particular customer that I was looking at, for instance, just to give you kind of a different perspective on it, was a governmental entity. I mean, they're an agency of a government of a country. And their problem was that the entire reason that this particular agency exists is to serve their citizens, okay, in one particular way. Well, the problem is they started looking through all of their different programs that they had that do different aspects of the way they interact with the citizens, and they found out they had several hundred representations of the citizen. Mm-hmm. So they couldn't answer the simple question that someone would go into one of their offices and say, which is that if there's a person, asking a question, is that the same person that filled out this form last year or filled out this other form this other year? They couldn't answer the question because there were just too many copies of the citizen's information running around. So if you think about it, that might be something that, that sounds like, well, microservices to the rescue, that would solve that problem. Sort of, kinda. The way they ended up actually addressing that problem was through master data management, mm-hmm. which is the idea of actually looking at it from the data up and then reconciling the databases so you end up with one database representation of your customer or of, in this particular case, the citizen. Mm-hmm. And that really solved their problem. Now, as a side effect of that, a lot of these master data management tools, including the ones from IBM, do end up providing APIs on top of the data representations of, the customer or of the citizen or whatever other entities you're trying to collapse mm-hmm. these things down into. And in the end, that's all we're really after in a microservices approach. We're looking for that one final API that we don't have lots of different APIs for lots of different slight variations of things running around. So that's, a case where microservices wasn't necessarily the right approach, but you still get to the same end by following a different path. And that's something that when you're looking at enterprise data as a whole, you want to make sure you address it.
So some of the tenants of microservices helped in this situation, but not necessarily microservices themselves.
Yep.
So just like you said, not everybody needs to go to Netflix scale, and not everybody needs to start out with thousands of microservices.
Yep.
So everybody's not going to be consuming or deploying microservices the same way. Pretty much there's going to be a pretty large spectrum of data or types of data inside these enterprise applications that you may be looking to refactor.
Yep.
So what are some of those other types of data we'd want to kind of touch on in that area?
Yeah, well, you know, once you kind of back away from the idea of, you know, I'm going to look at my entire entity relationship diagram for my whole enterprise and I'm just going to crack it into 100 pieces. You know, once you get away from that and you start looking at the places where microservices can give you real benefit because they are giving you problems. And that's really the key. You know, you only want to implement microservices in those cases where you actually have a reason to, that your code or the combination of your data and your code are giving you issues that you need to address. So there's three particular cases that I've seen that are like perfect examples of that, to where you have these little islands that you can look at and solve a particular problem with microservices and refactoring of your data, okay? First one is like, it's almost a total gimme on this, you know. There's so many times that I have walked into a customer and we've sat down and we've started either talking in detail about their architecture or even worse, I start reading their code, you know, because I do an awful lot of code review.
Mm-hmm.
And you get down to the bottommost layer of their data code, you know, where they're writing their data access objects or, you know, other, you know, things like that. And you find out that what they're actually doing is they're storing their data not through real object relational mapping, but they're just serializing objects, especially in Java, and then shoving the thing into a blob column. Now, you know, if you're doing that, you're kind of already not really bought into the whole relational model. And it's pretty much going to be guaranteed that that part of the data that you're shoving into a blob column is going to be disconnected from the rest of your data model. So it's already an isolated island. In that case, it's probably better to look at instead some sort of data model that is better suited for the type of data that they're actually storing. Now, a lot of times when you see this, what they're actually doing is they're just storing something that would better fit into something like a key value store.
Mm-hmm.
So if you wanted to look at a NoSQL database that supports a key value store, something, you know, like a Redis or the data cache in IBM Bluemix, that would probably be a much better solution that would not only make the code simpler, because you don't have to write, you know, this thing that's going to serialize it and shove it into a blob and then
deserialize
it. That's all handled for you. You can instead just look at a simpler API that's going to give you something that is going to be much better suited to the type of data you're doing, while at the same time it's probably going to be more scalable as well. Yeah. So that's the first case. Second case that we also see, again, as you look at the representation of your data, and this is something that sticks out a lot as you're looking at an ER diagram, is a lot of times, again, I've sat down and I've looked at people's code, and there's one pattern in particular that kind of sticks out at me. And back when Martin Fowler was writing The Patterns of Enterprise Application Architectures, I corresponded with him a lot and did a lot of reviews of it. And the pattern that kind of I never was comfortable with was the active record pattern.
Okay.
Because the active record pattern really only works in these situations to where the thing that you're storing in a database is flat. Well, if it's flat, by definition, it doesn't have relationships to other things
exactly.
in your database. And whenever you have that, you have these little isolated tables that don't have connections to other parts of your data model, you're probably looking at something that would be better suited to be stored somewhere else. In fact, what we've seen now that these have become much more common is that in most of these cases, it's really a document that you're storing. Because as you step back and you look at these kind of things and you say, well, what is it that, you know, is so flat? It's things like survey results or, you know, past orders, you know, to where you've already, taken it out of the rest of the data model and all you're doing is just storing like a textual representation of it.
Mm-hmm.
Well, if all you're storing is raw text and all you're storing is, you know, maybe a little bit of metadata description of what's in that text, that is by definition what a document model is. So therefore something like Cloudant, you know, or Mongo or something like that is going to be a much better match for the data than trying to make it work into a relational database, especially where it's not going to be connected to anything else. So that's another case to where it really just is kind of obvious as you look at the data. And then the final one is going to be a lot more complicated. This one, I have to go back to one time that I was working with a customer, and we spent months working on this particular project. It was a heavy-duty financial modeling system. So if you think about it, what we were trying to model was this whole idea that you can have tranches or divisions of different pools of stocks and mutual funds and equities and, you know, loan obligations and things like that, all of which are made up of other combinations of things, like a mutual fund is made up of a bunch of other stocks. Well, all of these things have pricing information, and that pricing information is all done in terms of specific currencies, you know, and those all have, you know, information about when it was valuated and things like that. And all they were trying to do in the end was come up with a price for these things. And the way this ended up working, it was what we ended up calling the query from hell.
I can imagine.
Was this 8 or 9 way join that would run over hundreds of thousands of rows of data and took forever to do, even when they were running it, you know, on these huge high power database machines in a batch mode. Well, you know, in retrospect, in hindsight, as we're looking back on this, you know, I realized that this whole problem of what we were representing was a graph. You know, and graph theory really describes the kinds of things we were doing, because we were doing traversals of the graph to get to the leaves of the tree and, you know, actually do things down at the bottom and then pull all that up. And in other cases, we were doing edge traversals for different reasons to, you know, find out things about the different aspects of what we were looking at. But given that this was all based around graph theory, today we can actually look at it and say, wow, a graph database would be absolutely perfect. So the Bluemix graph database or Neo-J or something like that would have been a much better choice than what we did instead, which was we created this nasty subset of the enterprise data model that we had to force fit into the relational model. And had we looked at it and simply said, no, really, this piece should have been a graph database and the rest of it should have been a relational model, it would have in the end been a much better solution than what we came up with, and it would have saved us a lot of time and pain and energy and grief.
Well, it definitely sounds like there's a couple of patterns or even anti-patterns that have evolved in some of these enterprise level applications that with a little bit of elbow grease, you'll be able to get a microservices oriented approach to some of your data access and really make it easier to develop new apps on top of it. Right. And then just kind of, like you said, make the developer's life easier, but also operations, right, you know, DBAs, things like that in the future.
Absolutely, because if you look at it from a data perspective, and you're thinking about what is the type of data that you're manipulating and what's the right format for that data. Is it naturally a graph? Is it naturally a document? Is it naturally just a hash map of keys and values? That's going to give you a better indication for that particular aspect of your overall enterprise system as to how it ought to be stored. And once you get to that, that's going to motivate you then to be able to look at how do you represent that as an API, and that's going to lead you straight back into implementing these as microservices.
Awesome. I mean, that's some great information. I mean, I know those different types of data, our customers are going to see probably many representations of those throughout. It's not all gloom and doom for DBAs. They'll definitely have a place in the future. But I mean, that's a good way to get started on the tail end of our other conversation and following up with this. So thanks again for joining us. And I'm sure we'll have some more topics to talk about in the future. For Kyle Brown, I'm Rick Osowski signing off for this week's edition of Microservices TV. And be sure to check out DeveloperWorks TV on IBM.com. Thank you.